Today we will discuss about the structures of proteins. Previously it has been discussed that proteins are made up of amino acids, and these amino acids are linked by peptide linkages. Jacob Berzelius first used the term protein, and he derived the term protein from proteos, which means that it appears as the principal or the primary substance of animal nutrition. And another scientist was a Dutch organic chemist who described the chemical composition of proteins, and he was the first to use the name coined by Jacob Berzelius on his paper. He was Mulder. What is a polypeptide molecule? Several amino acids, when linked with peptide bonds, form a polymer, and this is known as the polypeptide. And if the number of these monomeric amino acids is less, so it is called an oligopeptide. And if it is, in case of proteins, if it is much more, that is around 1000, several hundreds, thousands, then it is the protein. So the method is actually the same which is employed in case of oligopeptides or proteins. The sequence means the arrangement of the amino acids. And in a polypeptide, the N-terminal end and there is another C-terminal end. These at the N-terminal end, the NH2 group is free of the first amino acid, and at the C-terminal end, the carboxyl group is free of the last amino acid. So the peptide sequencing method will tell us which amino acid comes after which, and so on. So the reagent used and the method used. Method used is Edman's degradation method, and the reagent used is phenyl isothiocyanate. And this molecule reacts with the N-terminal amino acid first, whose amino group is free, and it forms a compound then released from the peptide in the form of a hydantoin derivative, phenyl thiohydantoin derivative of that particular amino acid, and the rest of the amino acids remain intact. So after the completion of the first round, if we can collect this hydantoin derivative and analyze, we can find which amino acid was there at the beginning, and in successive rounds, in after the end of each round, we will get each phenyl hydantoin thiohydantoin derivative of the N-terminal amino acid, and the sequence can be easily detected. So this is the method commonly used nowadays for amino acid sequencing. Now if we only want to know the N-terminal end of the polypeptide, which amino acid is there in the N-terminal end, we are not bothered with the sequence, suppose. So the reagents commonly used are fluorodinitrobenzene, dapsyl chloride, diacyl chloride. And the example of dapsyl chloride has been shown. This is aromatic compound, and it is attached with the N-terminal group end of the polypeptide, and that is called labeling, and it is labeled and a derivative has been formed, and after hydrolysis with 6 normal hydrochloric acid boiling, so the dapsyl chloride derivative will be detached from the rest of the amino acids in the peptide, and all the other amino acids will also be released. So the derivative and the amino acid which has been derivatized will show which amino acid was there in the first N-terminal end. So the N-terminal end can be determined. Now C-terminal end determination. Similarly, C-terminal end, only the C-terminal amino acid can be determined, and the reagent is used is hydrazine. Hydrazine will form a derivative with the amino acid whose carboxyl group is free. That means it will form the derivative at the C-terminal end, and the amino acyl hydrazide will be formed, and all the other amino acids will be released as free amino acid. So again, the derivative whose hydrazide compound has been found, has been derived, and it can be detected or analyzed to see which amino acyl hydrazide has has been formed, and this will again throw light about the C-terminal end. And similarly, other enzymatic methods are also there, the exopeptidase method, carboxypeptidase. These are enzymatic methods. Exo means enzymes will cut from one side, and carboxypeptidase means from the carboxyl side. And the amino acid which will be released after this carboxypeptidase cleavage will give the idea about the C-terminal end. Several enzymes are also used to find the N-terminal end also, that is aminopeptidase. In case of complex, the situation is much simpler for a polypeptide or oligopeptide. But in case of a protein, several other techniques are used to analyze each polypeptides, because oligopeptide peptides are cut from the protein by using several endopeptidases. Endopeptidases means trypsin, chymotrypsin, and several other enzymes are also there, pepsin. They degrade the protein molecule after particular amino acid, and then set of oligopeptides are derived, and from these sequencing of these oligopeptides, the entire peptide length protein can be sequenced. Much easier techniques. And several reagents, chemical reagents are also used, like cyanogen bromide. Cyanogen bromide cuts after the methionine residue, from the carboxyl end of the methionine residue. Then several reducing agents can be used to break some linkages present in the oligopeptide. Now, the primary, secondary, and tertiary and quaternary, these are the four structures, types of structures, or the levels of structures that are prevalent in the protein molecule. So, the primary structure means how the peptide bonds are formed between two amino acids, and hence several peptide bonds are there to complete the amino acid, entire amino acid sequence forming the protein. This is the structure of the peptide bond. The peptide linkage is partially double bond in character, that is CN bond, and this is evident from the bond length. The CN bond is in between a pure single bond and a pure double bond. And other single bonds present, and those are important for maintaining the structure, these are the C alpha C bond and C alpha N bond. These are pure single bonds, and they are free to rotate. This is one C alpha atom, and this is another C alpha, adjacent C alpha. These R and H, they are protruding here in this direction, and in this C alpha, they are protruding downwards. This means they are in transposition. The adjacent C alpha are in transposition, and the reason is quite evident or quite obvious, because by maintaining the transposition, steric compulsions will be relieved, and there is much less steric inhibition or hindrance. Normally, and it is a rule, you can tell that these are the C alpha, adjacent C alpha are in the transposition and not in the cis. So, it can be shown that there is steric hindrance or repulsion, but this is quite far away. This is in this one, the carbon C alpha is in this orientation, in this orientation, and hence no repulsion, steric repulsion. But this rule is violated in case of transproline or cisproline. Here cisproline is the predominant form, because again, because of steric compulsions and in the peculiarity of the proline structure, because there is no NH group, all this is bonded in such a way that N, only N can be found, and this N is bonded to two carbon atoms in a tetrahedral conformation. So, this trans conformation is not much stable as compared to the cis. So, cis is the favored conformation. I have already mentioned that this C alpha C bond is a single bond and it can rotate, and this C alpha and N bond is also a single bond and it can rotate. But are all these rotations free or is there any hindrance of assuming any type of rotation, any angle of rotation. So, to answer this question, Ramachandran plot has been derived by the scientist Ramachandran, where he analyzed which angular rotation is permissible to maintain the structure. So, before explaining the Ramachandran plot, we must discuss about the type of angles. If the angle of rotation has been visualized like that, suppose C alpha is in one plane and N is in another plane, and this bond can rotate. So, these N and C alpha are not in the same plane anymore after rotation, and if the first the plane of the nitrogen is superimposed on that plane of the C alpha carbon, then an angle or plus alpha, because rotation is in this direction, that is in the clockwise direction. So, the angle is designated as plus alpha and we call it omega. The angle is called as omega, the planes of these two carbon and nitrogen after the rotation will give an angle, and that is called a dihedral angle. And this angle denotes plus if the rotation is in the clockwise direction, and if it is minus, then the rotation is in the anti-clockwise direction. So, plus phi, this means that you are mainly concerned with the angular movement or the rotation of the C alpha N bond, not the C alpha C. And in case of C alpha C bond, psi angle has been designated. Similarly, this alpha carbon is in one plane and the carbon after rotation of the C alpha C, this C will be in another plane, and if these two planes are superimposed on one another, an angle will be formed, and that angle denotes the psi. So, phi and psi are the two critical angles which will determine what type of orientations of these bonds are. The Ramachandran plot for L-alanine residues have been shown, and the deep blue region, these corresponding angles of phi and psi are allowed, are permissible, and this dark blue means they are highly favored compared to this light blue shades. An entire region, we can find any phi and the corresponding psi angles after plotting, and the lightest of them shows that they are not so much favorable. And in this plane region, that means these phi and psi values are not at all permissible to maintain the structure. And these are all calculated by Ramachandran on the basis of van der Waals radii and bond angles, and other such assumptions were taken, and some steric interference factors were all taken into account to draw this plot. And this is also the Ramachandran plot showing the regions where there are beta sheets or alpha helix portion, these corresponding angles. Now, the question arises, what are alpha helix and beta sheets? These are the two main types of secondary structures of the protein. So, the primary structure means the entire amino acid sequence. The higher level structure is the secondary structure after primary. For hypothesizing the alpha helix and beta sheet structures, names of these scientists are very important, and they played a very important role in elucidating the alpha helix structure and beta sheet structure. The alpha helix is supposed to be a polypeptide chain which is wound around an imaginary axis with 3.6 amino acid residues per turn, and each turn is about 5.4 angstrom long, that is the axial length, and the pitch per amino acid is 1.5 angstrom, that means 5.4 divided by 3.6 per amino acid, the rise is 1.5 angstrom around the imaginary axis, there is no such real axis. The angle between the successive residues is about 100 degree, phi and psi values are denoted. The R groups point outwards, and the alpha helixes are stabilized by hydrogen bonds, because something must be there to stabilize the alpha helix structure. And which members are competing or forming the hydrogen bonds? The carboxyl carbon and the amino hydrogen. And the amino acid which are involved is carboxy. If the carboxy at oxygen is one first amino acid, then number 4 amino acid will donate the amino hydrogen for the hydrogen bonding, and so on. So second will bond with 5, and so on. First with 4, second with 5, and so on. And the hydrogen bond loop totals 13 atoms. So these alpha helices are sometimes called 3.6 13 helices, because in this helix the nomenclature is such that 3.6 residues are there, amino acid residues are there in per turn, and 13 atoms are there per turn. So 3.6 13. In theory, the turn of the helix could be clockwise or counterclockwise or anticlockwise. So however, in practice, counterclockwise rotation is observed. Such helices are called right-handed, because if you hold the right hand with the thumb pointing from the end to the C terminus, the tips of the curled fingers like this move anticlockwise. Similarly, a clockwise helix would be called left-handed. Left-handed helices are improbable for L amino acids, because the beta carbon and the carbonyl oxygen would collide, because we know that L amino acids are there in the building blocks of proteins. And if left-handed helixes are formed, then this problem will arise for L amino acids. So this is an improbable situation, and then though, so left-handed helices are improbable for forming the alpha helix. So right-handed helix. So alpha helix is a right-handed helix. This suggests the structure, and this is the top view of the alpha helix. This is suppose a rod-like structure, and if we look from top. Now the hydrogen bonding is, which already I have mentioned, is depicted here, and this is again a projection diagram for the right-handed alpha helix. Again, this is the top view. In addition to alpha helices, there are two other. These are the rarer, much rarer helical conformations, and this is the 310 helix with three residues per turn and hydrogen bonds between residue I and residue I plus 3. That there in alpha helix it was I plus 4 and phi psi values. The pi helix with has 5 residues per turn and a hydrogen bonding between residues I and I plus 5. And it has been seen that the 310 helix is often found at the ends of the alpha helices, and these are the closing the ends of the alpha helices. Again, this is the top view of alpha helix, 310 helix and pi helix. So look at this, that they are like a tapering form, and at the end they will ultimately seal the, close the alpha helix, because alpha helix top view is a circular, and later on it is tapering in case if there is 310 helix. Beta sheet, another important structure or secondary structure of the proteins. The main difference between alpha helix and beta sheet is that the beta sheet is a much extended form of arrangement. Alpha helix was much compact. In beta sheet, there is also the role of hydrogen bonding, and the hydrogen bonding is all again stabilizing the beta sheet. The hydrogen bonding is between two strands of the beta sheet. This is one polypeptide, this is another segment of polypeptide, and in beta sheet the hydrogen bonding is between these two and many more also. And this is again the top view, and this is the side view, and this is the anti-parallel arrangement of the beta sheet, because in this strand, these are the beta strands singular strands. This is another strand. This is another strand. This in this strand, the N-terminal end is over here, and the C-terminal end is over here. And in the opposite same corresponding strand, the opposite direction has been maintained. That means N here, C here, and hence it is called antiparallel. Third strand is again opposite with respect to the second one, and again parallel arrangement can be possible, is possible in case of beta sheets, where N terminal to C terminal, again the next strand is also N terminal to C terminal. The hydrogen bonding is between CO and NH of peptides, the peptide linkage between this strand and this strand. So here there is inter-strand hydrogen bonding, and in case of alpha helix there was intra-strand hydrogen bonding. This is the side view of the parallel beta sheet. Beta turns, or it told as reverse turns, and they suggest that the amino acid sequence was oriented downward to upward, the strand was going like that. Suddenly there is a turn, and the strand move direction of the arrangement becomes the opposite, just the reverse. This means a U has been formed, and this is the reason of reverse turn or beta turn. These beta turns are responsible for making a globular structure of the protein. Otherwise, there will be no turning points in the protein, and the protein will be a extended chain like structure. So the beta turns or reverse turns are very important for making a protein globular, that is much more compact. And again, apart from this reverse turn, there are loops called omega loops. And these omega loops also, they are in conjunction with the beta turns. Intervening regions have omega loops, and somewhere there are beta turns. Then again alpha helix, beta pleated sheet, and a combination of all the things can be found in a structural or in a functional form of the protein. So omega loops, it has been found that they are on the surface of the protein molecule, so that they are helpful or useful for protein-protein interaction between another protein to another protein. So they are just like linkers between the two protein-protein interaction. Now there are two types of turns, type 1 turn and type 2 turn. It has been seen that type 1 turn occurs more frequently than type 2 turns. And in type 2 turn, the difference is that they have glycine at the every third residue, but not in case of type 1 turn. And the hydrogen bonding has been shown in these two situations, in type 1 and type 2 turns. In the hierarchy of the protein structures, we first find the primary structure, the amino acid sequence, and then comes the secondary structure. These are the regularly repeating local structures stabilized by hydrogen bonds, and the most common examples are the alpha helix, beta sheet, and turns. Since secondary structures are local, many regions of different secondary structures can be present in the same molecule, same protein molecule. Next, what is the tertiary structure? No, why it is called tertiary? Because it is the third level of structure, first level, second level, and third level. So tertiary, and it is very important to give the overall shape of a single protein molecule, and the spatial relationship of the secondary structures to one another. And tertiary structure is generally stabilized by non-local interactions, because faraway portions also can come in close contact with the with another region of the protein, and so these are called non-local interactions. And which type of interactions are mentioned? The most commonly is the formation of a hydrophobic core through salt bridges or hydrogen bonding, and then disulfide bonds nearby sulfur can form disulfide linkage with a faraway sulfur. Cysteine residues are involved here to form the disulfide bonds, and the cysteine-cysteine linkage, SS linkages, will give rise to a disulfide linkage, and they are important for maintaining the tertiary structure. And again, even post-translational modification. The term tertiary is often used as synonymous with the term fold. The tertiary structure is what controls the basic function of the protein. And the quaternary structure is the structure formed by several polypeptide chains, and usually a protein subunits in this context. So after the subunit assembly is complete, then they can function as a single protein complex. Now this is the schematic diagram of the primary structure and the secondary structure. This is the alpha helix, this is the beta sheet. Beta sheet is much more extended. If you can stretch, they would be much more extended rather than alpha helix. Now after that, tertiary and quaternary structures follow the third level and the fourth level of the protein structure. Some peculiar secondary structures are found in some fibrous proteins like keratin and collagen. This is the schematic diagram of keratin. Keratin has double helical structure, and each this blue strand and the pink strand, each of them are also helical. So it is an helix within a helix. And in collagen, this is a triple helical structure. And the important characteristics of collagen is that their high tensile strength without stretch. Collagen of tendons, bone matrix, they are elongated molecules, multimeric proteins. They extend the tensile strength. They are found in bones, cartilage. They function as very important structural proteins also. And alpha and beta keratin suggests that they are alpha helical and beta splitted sheets, beta strands. And there are two types of keratins, which are called alpha keratin and beta keratin. And they also are tough, insoluble protective structures for varying hardness and flexibility. Alpha keratin examples of occurrences are alpha keratin of hair, feather and nails. And beta conformation is soft and flexible filaments such as in silk fibroin. In alpha keratin, the name suggests it is hard and it is rich in sulfur containing amino acids, but compared to beta conformation, which is much more soft and flexible. And the amino acid sequence, each fragment has around 310 amino acid sequence residue at the central portion of this filament, and it has an heptad repeat sequence within the central region of the 310 amino acids. And this heptad region is important in maintaining the helical structure of the helix keratin. And in beta keratin, there are beta, much like beta pleated sheet. And in triple helix of collagen, we find that every third amino acid is a glycine, and the collagen is rich in hydroxyproline and hydroxylysine. These are the peculiar features of collagen, and every third is a glycine.